point A around point B, that makes a circle. But these two single points are clones, and those two points have equal potential. So not only can point A rotate around point B, but point B can also rotate around point A. This is one radius that both circles share. That black form in the middle there, that's called the vesica piscis or the vesica piscis, depending on what you prefer. The vesica piscis is literally the womb of the universe. This is the whole essence of the universe. I'm not kidding. Sounds like a real crazy thing to say, but two circles of common radius and this shape in the middle that it makes, called the vesica piscis, is the whole root of sacred geometry. Literally, every single thing that exists, and I'm not kidding, everything that exists springs out of this womb, this football-like shape. It sounds like a wild, improbable, crazy thing to say, but it's absolutely true.
On February the 23rd, 1987, a bright new star lit up in the Large Magellanic Cloud, the largest companion galaxy of the Milky Way, 167,000 light-years away. The enormous brightness immediately suggested that it was a supernova. Named Supernova 1987A, it was the closest such event that was visible to the naked eye since Kepler's supernova of 1604. It offered modern astronomy a unique possibility to study the death of the blue supergiant star Sanduliac -69202. Although the glittering light of the explosion has faded away long ago, supernova 1987A still presents a spectacular display. It is surrounded by a thick ring of glowing gas in the equatorial plane. Two larger but fainter rings can be seen above the poles. The origin of these rings is not fully understood. They are probably composed of material which has been lost by the pre-supernova star about 20,000 years before the explosion. The series of four panels shows the evolution of the supernova debris. A decade after the explosion, the matter ejected from the stellar interior has expanded enough to be resolved with the Hubble Space Telescope. Ahead of the stellar debris, the supernova shock tears into the circumstellar medium. The initial flash of light from the supernova explosion causes the ring to glow. Debris hurl into space, the fastest moving at 1/10 the speed of light. The supernova's shock wave causes the ring to glow again. The closer the pieces of the ring are to the shock wave, the sooner they light up. Eventually, the whole ring lights up. Hubble observations in 1997 showed a brightening knot at the inner edge of the equatorial ring. This was the first sign of the dramatic and powerful collision between the outward moving blast wave and the ring material. This collision will continue over the next few years. It will rejuvenate supernova 1987A as a powerful source of radiation. Supernova 1987A marked
the proof of God, or whatever you want to call it, God. Say, Luke, we look for proof. And you're entitled to that. What would you say if I had the power to come down to you and say, look, Norma, Al, I'm going to give you a piece of paper. You've seen this done in Atlantic City, but I mean, this is real stuff. I'm going to give you a piece of paper with something written on it. Okay? You hold that. Hold it close to you. And then I'll make something happen in the sky over your head. And you put them both on a piece of paper the same size, and one will fit perfectly with the other. Does that fit? I mean, here's the paper. You keep that. And I'm going to make something happen in the sky. And I'll tell you. You know, tell you when it's going to happen. Okay. That should be fairly good proof. Because to me, unless anybody wants to provide you for proof and documentation, I mean, I wouldn't pay any attention to them. But here's a thing that we should demand proof. I mean, if to say to God, God, you got a bad name, you got a bad rap, you're going to blow up everybody and you're killing everybody, and I mean, I'm not too happy with your whole plan. You got proof? Let's say it. Put it up or shut up, God. You get out of here. Don't bother me. So can we find proof of the existence of God, or at least an intelligence that lies beyond the realm of our understanding? Is there anything? Let us do this little study then. I'll be God. If I'm God and I look at you and say, all right, all of you angles of light sitting here, I'm going to provide you with a diagram. And this diagram is yours to keep. And I want you to keep the diagram in a very safe place. Because when the time is ready, I'm going to make something happen in the sky. At that point, you will have evolved to a point of understanding. So you'll take the picture of what goes on in the sky, and you'll connect it to the diagram that I'm going to give you now. In the time of Uranus, father of the Cyclops, power of the single eye, I will place this eye in the sky. And when you take a picture of that eye, it will perfectly fit the diagram that I'm giving you now. Will that be proof? And if I was to tell you that, if I was to come down and I was to say to you, Mike, I'll give it to you, and you've got it on an 8.5 by 11 piece of paper, and then I'll make something happen in the sky. And what I make happen in the sky will fit exactly there, and that pattern will be exact. We say, well, that's all I want. Just do that one thing, and I'll believe you. Right. Okay. Would the little angles come up and distribute as quickly as you can? Now this is the diagram. This is the diagram that I want you to hold, because after you have this diagram, now remember, this nothing's happened here. We don't know anything. This is a nut giving diagrams out to people in this basement in the Fork and River, whoever it is. So he's giving diagrams out to, it's a crazy guy, he's giving diagrams out to people. Okay? But what I'm saying to you is something is going to happen in the sky. Would you and your little angles give out the diagram? And then, Joan, after you give them out, I want you to share it with the people on television. Now, each of you can take that home with you. How do you like that? That diagram was created a couple of thousand years ago, or 1,000 years ago in Greece, and it's known as the Harmony of Apollo. And everybody on television will show you the diagram in just a moment. All right? Now, isn't that good? Now, the point is to remember that that diagram was made 2,000 years ago. Joan, would you please show the diagram to the people on television? All right. A piece of white paper behind it, and they'll be able to see it, okay? That's the diagram. Now, this is what I want you to keep in mind. You've got the diagram, and you're putting it in your dresser drawer, and you're going to wait then for something to happen in the sky to see if, you know, this diagram comes true. This diagram was put together by the Greeks about 2,000 years ago. You got that? Okay, fine. All right. Now the time comes and you get to the age of Aquarius. Now remember, you've got the diagram, you get to the age of Aquarius, and you start looking at all the things we've been talking about today, about Eurytus and all that stuff. This is the time. And then you start looking at each other, and you say, hey, you remember when that guy called himself God came down here, and he gave us his people? What the heck is this? I'm away for 2,000 years. This guy is a fakakta. I don't see nothing. What is this all about? Show me something. What, give me, you know. I think he's crazy. I think he's one of those religious right-wingers or something. He's trying to do some crazy business, you know. So you're sitting with this thing in your drawer, and all of a sudden, something happens. Here comes something on National Geographic. And the little angel girls get up again, and they're flittering all over the place, handing this one out. Okay? And there they go, circling around, and they're giving in. And now something has happened in the sky. And now we're going to take the diagram that was made 2,000 years ago, and we're going to see if it fits. And what do you know? It fits perfectly. Right when it was supposed to. In the age of Aquarius, during the reign of Uranus and the Cyclops, it fits perfectly. Okay? And so then we have to say, you know, wait a minute here. Maybe we got proof. I don't know what else the guy could do. He gave you the diagram. Then he made this celestial thing happen in the sky. He told you when it was going to happen, when the Son of Man would come and Pegasus and all this business, and there it is. See? So now you have to say to yourself, it looks good. It looks like we have proof here. John, would you show the people on television and then show them the overlay there? Okay? Now, if indeed we have been put on notice, this is the diagram of the all-consuming eye to be seen in the sky. You now have in your hands proof, don't you? I don't know what else. I mean, tell me, is it indicative of some kind of proof? Of course it could be a coincidence. But if it's not a coincidence, then you have an intelligence who gave us in advance a diagram of something that was going to happen in the sky near the year 2000, and you've got it. Okay?
There it is. That's it. When we get to four circles of common radius, which naturally evolve out of these points C and D, the vesica piscis is in the middle. But we have now five vesica piscis inside four circles of common radius. One, two, three, four, five. Ah, interesting. With the creation of those points C and D, we have within the vesica piscis a triangular situation. So we started with unity, we evolved into duality, and now we have an evolution to trinity. This is the birthplace of trigonometry. An entire division of mathematics born in the vesica piscis. Huh? Those two points, C and D, bisect the vesica piscis and create the cross in the center and a new center point X. So this introduces the transcendental nature of this pattern. It slips all the way into infinity and all the way out to infinity with smaller and smaller and smaller overlapping circles and larger and larger and larger overlapping circles. All the way to infinity. So, you can't learn about the vesica piscis.